What's up, guys, and welcome to another Cinehorde review. I figured since I'm in a horror film genre class, I will probably be doing more horror films because it makes sense that if I'm going to keep doing this, I might as well combine the two. So, this week's horror film retro review is Frankenstein, the 1931 version, starring Boris Karloff as Frankenstein's monster. This was an interesting movie because I realized I had never seen it all the way through. So, this film has a lot of markers to it that I want to talk about, but I'm going to try to do that in as little time as possible. It's interesting to see so much of what would become the prevalent style for the next 30 to 40 years present in this film. The camera movements are still relatively static compared to what we're used to today, but the cutting has a lot of energy to it. The shots are masterfully executed. The movie never seems to lag in terms of its pacing. It's really one of the super great examples of early horror films. I'm just gonna throw that out there. And then there's that scene with the little girl Maria and Boris Karloff's Frankenstein's monster playing by the river where they're throwing flowers and flowers float, right? Because of the surface area and how light they are. So Frankenstein's all like, "Wow, pretty things float. So I'm gonna throw the little girl in the water." And he doesn't understand that she's not coming back. From that point forward, though, that there's a darker tinge to the character of Frankenstein's monster. If you've ever seen this, near the beginning of the film, Fritz, who later becomes Igor in popular culture, tries to steal one of two brains from a medical laboratory, and he takes the one that is labeled abnormal brain. It was a brain from a murderer because he dropped the other one, the good brain, supposedly, because he got scared. Pretty funny, right? Yeah. So there's this running theme that as the monster comes to know itself, maybe it's inhabiting more of its innate nature. But then, if you juxtapose that with the tenderness in the scene with Maria, you can see traces of an earlier version of nature versus nurture being executed here, which was very cool. Another thing that I thought was interesting is the idea that the young Frankenstein, the doctor, Henry, in this movie, not Victor, he kind of represents someone who's on the fringe. He's still pretty sane, but he has some ideas that are not conventionally accepted, which puts him on the fringe of society. And what makes him different than other characters who position themselves that way is that he doesn't quite give up on the idea of convention, right? Like, he still wants to marry Elizabeth. He still wants to have a relatively normal life, but he has this ticking in his head that says, "I have to do this thing first." And when he creates the monster and it's not all that he wanted, he's very quick to abandon it. And, I think to some extent that's true for all of us, right? Once we do something and we're unhappy with the results rather than accepting personal responsibility for it and caring for the consequences that we've wrought, basically, we tend to just go away and return back to business as usual. And I think this is a very good example of that. And I would definitely recommend this to people who are fans of horror as a genre, or even like people who are really interested in film history but who've never seen that movie. I don't know who you would be, because most people who are into film history that I know, they've already seen this movie, and we've talked about this stuff ad nauseum. I hope you enjoyed the review. There will be a link. description and right here. And, you know, make sure to write, or read, rather, the written review. And don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, and share, and talk about movies with your friends. We'll see you later. Bye.